एक बार देखिए मैं आ रहा है।
हेलो हेलो।
हाँ सेम लिंक।
स्टार्ट है कुछ क्लिक करना है तो स्टार्ट है।
फर्स्ट पेज
इट इज रेडी गोइंग ऑन। गुड आफ्टरनून एवरीवन, सॉरी फॉर द डिले इन द स्टार्ट ऑफ द प्रैक्टिकल लेक्चर। बिकॉज ऑफ सम टेक्निकल इश्यूज वी कुड नॉट बिगिन ऑन टाइम, बट नाउ वील स्टार्ट कवर विद द मेडिकल एंटोमोलॉजी क्लास। So entomology is the study of arthropods of medical importance. So all these arthropods, they belong to different classes which include Insecta, Arachnida, Myriapoda, Pentastomida and Crustacea. So medically important arthropods which we'll be discussing today will be from the class Insecta, which include mosquito, black flies, house fly, sand fly, tsetse fly, lice. These all come under Insecta. Then is the class Arachnida, which contain tick, whether it is hard tick, soft tick, mites, and Crustacea, where it will discuss Cyclops. Now, why is the study of entomology important? Because these arthropods, they can act as vectors in transmission of various diseases. They can transfer certain organisms via their bite or through their secretions that go around the bite. So when they transfer any biological organism, the transmission can be classified into three types: propagative, cyclodevelopmental or cyclopropagative. Now propagative transmission, only the multiplication will happen inside that vector of the organism. Example is Yersinia pestis, only it multiplies inside the rat flea. So this is propagative transmission. Then there is cyclodevelopmental transmission. Here the organism develops or matures inside the vector. For example, Wuchereria bancrofti in mosquitoes. Then another type of transmission is cyclopropagative transmission. Here the organism will multiply as well as it will develop. Both things will take place inside the vector. For example, Plasmodium species. So you know Plasmodium, it multiplies as well as goes through various stages of development inside the mosquitoes. So you should know this basic three types of biological transmission along with its examples. Now these vectors can transmit various diseases. So mosquitoes, whether it is Anopheles, Aedes, Culex or Mansonia, they transmit various diseases including malaria, lymphatic filariasis, Japanese encephalitis, yellow fever, dengue, and the list goes on, right? Then there are tsetse flies, or they from the Glossina species, they can transmit sleeping sickness. Then Phleobotomin or the sand fly, it can transmit leishmaniasis. Black flies transmit liver blindness or onchocerciasis. Fleas can lead to plague or marine typhus. Then body louse, it can lead to typhus fever or louse-borne relapsing fever. Ticks, they transmit tick-borne relapsing fever, rickettsial fever, Lyme's disease. Mites, the trombiculid mite, it transmits scrub typhus. So now we'll start with mosquitoes and Dr. Sai Lakshmi will start with your spots.
Good afternoon, everyone. Now let us read the mosquitoes individually. First, we will read about the Anopheles mosquito. The female Anopheles mosquito is the one which takes the which requires blood meal for the development of its eggs, and during that process only they give the infective organisms like Plasmodium and other, and infect the humans. So as we can see here, the female Anopheline mosquito or Anopheline mosquito, when they rest, it makes an angle of 45 degree or so to the surface with the proboscis, which is the mouth part, and the abdomen, they make a straight line. And here the Anopheles mosquito, the wings are spotted. So it is a they rest with the whole body at the angle of 45 degree to the surface. The Anopheles here breeds in the fresh water, which is a very important characteristics of these group of mosquitoes. And they lay eggs which are boat shaped singly in the water, and they have lateral floats. And Anopheles pupa and larvae, they don't have any siphon tube. So the Anopheles is a vector for malaria, filariasis and other diseases that I mentioned by Dr. Swati. Now coming to Culex. Culex is found everywhere in India. It mainly breeds in dirty water collections, in contrast with Anopheles, which breeds in fresh water collections. And Culex, another differentiating point is they lay eggs in cluster or rafts. And they can fly up to 11 kilometer distance, and they are usually the night biters. They mainly bite on the legs below the knee, and they enter the house at dusk and reaches maximum by midnight. So two species of Culex, which is the Culex cunci fasciatus and Culex vishnui, Culex tritaniorhynchus, these are very important. This Culex cunci fasciatus transmits the Bancroftian filariasis, filaria caused by Vigeria bancrofti, and West Nile fever, which is a viral disease. Culex tritaniorhynchus and Culex vishnui, they transmit another viral disease, which is the Japanese encephalitis. So here we can see the Culex proboscis and the body of the Culex, they make a certain angle. Whereas as I showed in Anopheles, the proboscis and the body, they were forming a straight line. And its body, Culex holds its body parallel to the resting surface, with proboscis bent downward relative to the surface, while the Anopheles body is making 45 degree angle with the surface. This is the differentiating features between Culex and Anopheles. Next, coming to Aedes aegypti, which belongs to the class Insecta, genus Aedes. The identifying features of Aedes mosquito is that the body of the body and the legs of the mosquito is striped. Hence, because of this appearance, they are known as tiger mosquito. And the resting posture is the hunchback posture. And this black and white stripes in legs and abdomen makes it a tiger mosquito. It's widely distributed in India, and it's a vector for many diseases like dengue fever, chikungunya, yellow fever, Zika virus. Now, the tip of the abdomen of Aedes is pointed, and it's rest in a hunchback position. And it is abundant during the rainy season. So as we can see now, the dengue is like causing high occurrence. High number of patients are suffering from dengue now in the rainy season, mainly due to the Aedes mosquitoes. Now the body is slightly bent downward. Body shows a hunchback at rest, and the wings are unspotted. The biting time of Aedes is during the daytime, and important species are Aedes aegypti and Aedes albopictus. Both of the species are important, equally important in transmitting diseases like dengue, chikungunya fever, yellow fever, Rift Valley fever, Zika fever. Now coming to Mansonia, it is another species of genus of mosquito, which are big black brown mosquitoes. And the wing scales are large and blunt, and it is the major vector of filariasis caused by Brugia malai, also known as Malayan fly filariasis. So Mansonia, unlike Culex and Aedes, they breed in ponds and lakes that contain certain aquatic plants, and they transmit, as I've already told, Brugia malai infection of filariasis. Now coming to the difference in the eggs, larva, pupae and adult of Anopheles and Culicine mosquito. Anopheles is all present only in Anopheline, and the Culicine contains the Culex, Aedes and Mansonia. Anopheles, they lay eggs singly, and the eggs are boat shipped with lateral floats. Whereas the Culex, Culicine family, they lay eggs in clusters or rafts, and these are oval shaped without any lateral floats. The larvae of the Anopheles mosquito, they raced parallel to the water surface. As there is no siphon tube, so by exposing maximum to the water surface, they can get the oxygen. Whereas in case of Culex, the larva remains suspended with the head downwards at an angle to the water surface. As the larvae of the Culex remain in that position, so they have a siphon tube. The siphon tube is a tubular structure which helps in acquiring oxygen from the atmosphere. The pupae of the Anopheles also has siphon tube, which is broad and short, whereas the Culex siphon tube is long and narrow. In adult Anopheles mosquito, it rests inclined at an angle to the surface. The wings are spotted and palpi is long in both sexes. While in Culex adult, the body is in a hunchback posture, the wings are unspotted and the palpi are shorter in females. Now, as we can see here, the eggs of the Anopheles are having the floats and in laying singly, and the Culex it is in rafts, and Aedes also in some eggs are in singly also there, and the larvae of the Anopheles is remaining parallel to the water surface, while the Culex and Aedes it is forming an angle with the siphon tube. And the resting position of Anopheles, as we can see, it is forming an angle, whereas Culex and Aedes a hunched back position. Now, coming to black flies, the black flies are scientifically known as Simulium. It is also known as buffalo gnats and turkey gnats, and they measure about 2 to 4 millimeter, and they are blackish gray or sometimes dark yellow in color. And the Indian species is the Simulium indicum. Disease transmitted by black flies is onchocerciasis or river blindness by biting of the infected female fly. Now, next is the Diptera flies. They belong to the class Insecta, order Diptera, and mainly these organisms, the larva, they mainly infect the human being, which is and forms a miasis, disease known as miasis. Here head identifying features being the mouth parts which are having the biting with mandible and maxilla. Seeing the mouth parts only, we can differentiate the Diptera species flies. And the wings and wing pads here are absent, and there is one pair of unjointed prolegs or thorax present. Now, coming to biting midges, these are small robust insects which piercing and sucking mouth parts. And they are mainly responsible for acute discomfort, irritation and severe local reactions. Now, coming to a very important species, which is a sand fly, which belongs to genera Phlebotomus lutzomaya. Phlebotomus species being Phlebotomus argentipes. So here we can see the sand fly. It has antenna, proboscis, thorax, legs, abdomen, head and pair of wings. The important characteristic features to note that the head and the body and the legs, they are covered with feathers and or hairs. Hairy body and wings are present, and the wings of the sandfly, it has a double the second longitudinal vein shows a double branching, and the legs are longer than the body. The diseases transmitted are parasitic, like leishmaniasis, cutaneous, mucocutaneous and visceral, also known as calaza. In viral disease, transmit the chandipura encephalitis, papatis C, 3-day fever, also sandfly fever, and bacterial they transmit the oraya fever, Carrion's disease, which is caused by Bartonella baciliformis. Now, I would like to call upon Dr. Smith.
So, we'll continue with the insectum. So, fleas, so how can you identify them? They are small, bilaterally compressed. As you can see in this picture, the compression, it is bilaterally concept and a compressed and wingless insect. It has a hard chitinous exoskeleton, and you can see that the body is covered with backward directly directed strong bristles. These are ectoparasites, blood sucking. The head is conical, attached to thorax, and there's no neck.
thorax can be divided into three parts, the pro, meso and meta, and it has three pairs of leg. Now abdomen has 10 segments, male has coiled genitalia and female has spermatheca. These fleas, they cannot fly, they are wingless, they can jump less than 6 inches. Now this is of public health importance obviously. The fleas found on one particular kind of animal host will not usually seek the blood of another species or animals unless compelled by necessity. So if you want to identify, these are the overall identifying features, but overall if you want to see, it's an insecta, bilaterally compressed, small, wingless. So this is very important. And how many pairs of legs? Three pairs of legs, chitinous exoskeleton and bristles which are directing backwards on the body. So that is how you can identify a flea. Now you need to know what diseases can be transmitted. The examples are bubonic plague or marine typhus or epidemic typhus. Another flea we'll talk about, this picture is the of oriental rat flea or Xenopsylla chiopis. Another flea that we'll talk about is dog flea. Now these flea, they live as an ectoparasite on variety of mammals, particularly domestic dog and cats. It is the Tenocephalites canis. It very closely resembles to the cat flea, which can live on a wider range of animals. It has two rows of dark hard bristles on the head and thorax and relatively longer hind legs, which is required for jumping. And they can spread Diplodium caninum. Now we come on to study lice. Now lice, these are the arachnids now. Now they are small, wingless, permanent ectoparasites of man. Now the head is narrower than the thorax, and the thorax has three pairs of legs again. Now abdomen has 9 segments and it is bilobed in the female. Now lice are of three types: head louse, body louse or pubic or crab louse. The head louse is Pediculus humanus capitis, the body louse is Pediculus humanus corporis, and pubic or crab louse is Thyrus pubis. They lay eggs which are also known as nits, and these nits can be found attached to hairs. And the infestation by lice is referred to as pediculosis. Lice can act vector for epidemic typhus, epidemic relapsing fever, trench fever. If the infestation is there, which is known as pediculosis, it can lead to irritation and pruritus in the affected person. Now the identifying features of head louse or Pediculus humanus capitis. This head louse lives in the hair, and you can see the nits or the eggs which are attached to the hair. Now their body is dorsoventrally flattened, and the body is typically divided into head, thorax and abdomen, as you can see in this picture. In contrast to what we saw earlier in fleas, these are bilaterally compressed and the body demarcation is into head and thorax, not an egg. So here the body is dorsoventrally flattened, divided into head, thorax and abdomen. Now head is pointed and bears a pair of 5 segmented antennae. Thorax is square shaped and has 3 pairs of appendages. And last segment of the appendage ends with claws. The abdomen has 9 segments. The last segment in male is pointed, while in female it is bilobed. But the main identifying features, which is easier for you to identify, is the type of compression of the body and the division and the type of limbs or the appendages, the 3 pair of appendages in this. Then is the body louse or Pediculus humanus corporis. Now this louse can also be found on the body and as well as clothing, attached to the fibers of your various clothes. And this infestation is very common in crowded or low socioeconomic conditions where the unsanitary conditions can be practiced. Now it very much resembles the head louse, but there is no pigmentation and legs are more cylinder. While Thyrus pubis or the pubic louse, it resembles a crab and it is about 2 mm. It is attached to the pubic hair or sometimes even eyelashes. The body again can be divided into the head, thorax and abdomen. The thorax has 3 pairs of legs and the last segment of appendages ends with claws. So these are the common features of all the louse, but the resemblance of pubic clouse is very much to a crab. The abdomen has lateral projections, which are known as lateral papillae. And again, in females, the last abdominal segment is bifid, while not in males, they are not bifid. Next, we come to mites. Now, trombiculid mite. Now, mites per se, they contain four pairs of legs. In contrast to what we studied in louse, they had three pairs. Trombiculid mite has four pairs of legs, and a body is not that well demarcated into the three parts of head, thorax, and abdomen. Now, shiggers, which is the six-legged red larva of trombiculid mite, can transmit scrub typhus. As you know, scrub typhus is caused by Oryantia suzugamishii and can be transmitted to the larval stage of the shigger or the infected trombiculid mite. And the SCHAR is pathognomic of this scrub typhus. Another mite we'll study is the Sarcopitis KB. They are very small, tiny, 0.1 to 0.3 mm ectoparasites. They live in the epidermal layer of the skin. The body is divided into capitulum and abdomen. Eyes, antennae, and wings are absent. And they have two pairs of legs in front, two in behind. Front legs end in long tubular processes known as suckers. Hind legs, they end in long filamentous bristles. And in females, the fourth pair ends in suckers. But you can see, you can easily identify a mite separately from a body louse. The Sarcopitis KB, it causes human scabies. Now, scabies is characterized by intensely pruritic erythematous papular eruption caused by burrowing of adult female mites in the upper layers of the epidermis, creating a serpiginous burrow. Now, itching is most intense at night. The site of the lesions are generally hands, basically the interdigital spaces, and the extensor aspects of the arms. Then we come to ticks. Now, ticks are of two types, hard ticks and soft ticks. Now, it is important to know the difference. The upper picture is the hard tick and the lower picture is the soft tick. Now, hard ticks have a scutum which is absent from the soft tick. Now, this scutum covers the entire back in males while covers a small portion in females. To show the scutum, you can see in this picture. This is the anatomy of a hard tick or the ixodid. The scutum covers the entire back in males while a small portion in front of females. Then the difference in the head. The head is situated at the anterior end in the hard tick. In the soft tick, as you can see, it lies ventrally but is not visible if seen from above. Hard ticks can lay several hundreds or thousands egg in one sitting, while soft ticks, they lay in batches of 20 to 100 over a long time period. Hard ticks have generally one nymphal stage, while soft ticks can have five. Hard ticks cannot withstand starvation and feed night and day. Soft ticks can withstand starvation even for a year or more. So you can see this diagrammatic representation and the differences of hard tick and soft tick. The head is visible in case of hard tick, but in soft tick, since it's ventral, it is not visible. The important genera of hard tick include Dermacentor, Ixodes, and Haemophysialis, while soft tick, the example is Ornithodorus. The various diseases that can be transmitted to hard ticks are tick typhus, the Rocky Mountain spotted fever, viral encephalitis, hemorrhagic fever, tularemia, tick paralysis, human babesiosis, Lyme's disease, and KFD. While soft tick can transmit Q fever and endemic relapsing fever. Then we come to crustaceans. So the cyclops, remember this belongs to the class Crustacea, but are also known as water fleas. They are pear-shaped and semi-transparent body, and they have a forked tail and two pairs of antenna. There's a diagrammatic representation as you can see on the left side. They have a large cephalothorax and cylinder segmented abdomen with a single small pigmented eye. In females, the first abdominal segment has a pair of ovisac. the cyclops or the water fleas are a vector of Gerontocolis medinensis, or also known as the guinea worm. Now to compile, I had made a mistake initially, so I want to correct it. Just to revise back, the class Insecta contains mosquito, black flies, sand fly, house flies, SA fly, and lice. Arachnida has ticks, hard tick and soft tick, and mites, and crustacean has cyclops. Now just to go through it all over again. These are vectors for various diseases. Mosquitoes, whether Anopheles, Culex, AD or Mansonia, as we have discussed, various identifying features, can transmit malaria, filaria, dengue, viral hemorrhagic fever, viral encephalitis, etc. Sandfly can transmit Kala-Azar, Kyrion's disease, cutaneous leishmaniasis. SA fly can transmit sleeping sickness. Housefly can lead to diarrhea, amoebic and bacillary dysentery, cholera, typhoid, and many other diseases. The rat flea can transmit bubonic flea and endemic typhus. Lice can cause pediculosis and typhus, trench fever, European relapsing fever. Mite can transmit scabies and dermatitis. Cyclops can transmit guinea worm disease. And soft tick can transmit relapsing fever, Q fever, and hard tick, viral encephalitis fever, and tularemia, etc. Now for all the entomology we have studied today, you need to know, if you are focused with a slide or you are given a picture, you need to know what is the organism which is the arthropod that has been focused. So you need to know the basic identifying features. You may or may not be asked about them, but you need to know the basic identifying features of all these, which class they belong to, what diseases they can transmit and how do they transmit them, and basic vector control measures which need to be in place for them. Thank you.